Hello, I'm Jonathan Wyner, and welcome to another episode of Are You Listening? Before I get into today's subject, please go look at the iZotope.com website, find the Learn tab, and you'll find lots of blogs, videos, presets, pro audio essentials, lots of things that can help you get the results that you're after and help you in your creative journey. Today, I wanted to talk about something that is probably among the top three questions that I get, which has to do with levels. When you are mixing, what should the levels be? When you're mastering, what should the levels be? Why are they different? What should I be thinking about? So I'm going to break this down a little bit for you. So first of all, we need to think about mixing and mastering as two different things. If you try to do both at once, then the whole question kind of doesn't really make much sense. There is an Are You Listening video, by the way, about loudness as it relates to mastering specifically. Have a look at that. If we assume that a mastering pass, a mastering stage is something that's going to be happening after mixing, that starts to play into the discussion and some of the decisions about how we set levels. And so probably the easiest next thing to talk about then is about something called headroom, which happens to be the name of my podcast. But anyway, consider the fact that if you push your mix so that there is no headroom, if you push it all the way up, so your peaks are all the way up close to 0 dBFS, even with a little margin, and also taking into account the fact that anytime you do any kind of signal processing, you're going to end up with new peaks in your audio. Even if you use subtractive EQ or high-pass filtering or whatever, you're going to get new peak levels in new places. That means that in order to create some headroom, you're going to have to turn your mix that was at 0 dBFS down to process it and then turn it back up in mastering. Technically, that's not a problem, but you have to ask yourself, why did I turn my mix up in the first place? If you're working with a limiter in your mixing, and you've got a limiter sitting on the stereo bus, there's something about the sound of that that you really, really like, great, use it. Just recognize that if you push the level up, it'll get turned down a little bit in mastering before the level gets restored to maybe where you were during your mixing, maybe a little louder, maybe a little quieter. But if you're just pushing the level up just to light up the zero on your meter, stop doing that. There's no point. If you leave yourself some headroom, you won't have to turn the track down to work on it. And then you can turn it up and get the level that you're after in the context of the mastering process. Something else to consider, limiters are not transparent. They're not 100% transparent. They do leave an imprint on the sound. There's an episode, by the way, an Are You Listening episode about limiting, where I describe a little bit the imprint that limiters tend to make. But even if you're taking into account the change in the low end, the additional high frequency emphasis that comes from limiting, different models of limiter, even different modes in ozone, all sound a little bit different. When you limit, that sound is incorporated into what you're doing. And then if you have to limit again during mastering, you're going to get even more of that artifact. So that's all the more reason to think about, why am I pushing my level up? And what should my target level be? If you take a look at the RX interface, one of the things that's worth knowing about is something under the window menu that's called waveform statistics. If you pull up an audio file into this window, it will tell you everything that you might want to know about the level of your track. Your sample peak level and true peak level, which are basically, they're connected, but they're slightly different. It shows you RMS. It shows you your integrated LUFS level. Again, referring you back to the episode about loudness. We talked there some about LUFS and the different modes. But this will show you the level of each of these different mixes. So if you take a look at the different files that I've got pulled up here, you'll see that we've got different LUFS levels. Here we've got integrated LUFS at minus 15 with a peak level close to zero. If you look at the waveform, you can see it's pretty well articulated. There's not much in the way of limiting going on there. If I move over to this track, we've got peak levels that are down at minus 10, and we've got LUFS levels at minus 26. None of these are really problematic because, again, in mastering, we can turn up the track, right? We can move it to the level that we need to in order to get something for mastering. Now, The one thing you do want to pay some attention to is the difference between the peak level and the either integrated level or even better, the RMS level. If your peak level is vastly different compared to the RMS level, then you may have trouble later on getting the level to the point that you're happy with. And the converse is true. If you don't have much of a difference between peak and average, you may hear some artifacts around that where you've lost some liveliness and life in the track. So thinking about that relationship while you're mixing is probably the most important, as opposed to paying attention to the absolute value. So if I move over to Insight and play a track and look at the difference between the peak and the RMS, ideally I'm looking for a difference of something in the neighborhood of, say, 10 to 15 dB difference.
Waves beneath this crushed, breaking on the towering stones, splitting rays of sun on the shore.
So here you can see we're looking at an RMS level that's moving back and forth between minus 20 and minus 25 and a peak level of minus 9. What that means is that the persistent level, the RMS level that translates to loudness, is close enough to peak that we're going to be able to get a good healthy level out of this track, but it's not so great that I'm going to have problems in mastering. So here you see a slightly lower difference between them. The peak level is at minus 5, the RMS level is at about minus 15. Again, about a 10 dB difference between peak and average. As a rule of thumb, this is a pretty good range. And if you start seeing your difference between the two more than or much less than that 10 to 15 dB difference, you might want to rethink your balance between the different elements in a mix. Now, genre matters. If it's a solo flute recording, then the difference between peak and average is going to be much less. On the other hand, if you're recording a tap dancing record that's just tap dancing, you're going to have a much bigger peak to average ratio. In fact, I did master a tap dancing record once upon a time. There's one other issue when thinking about the level of what we're working on as it translates to what we're listening to. If you push levels really, really hard and are listening through an analog stage, a D to A converter, that's not really designed to handle very high listening levels, the playback of the system may be producing some distortion that could be problematic. It could be coloring what you're hearing. A lot of us are listening through devices like this. These are incredibly powerful, exquisitely engineered devices, but they're really not optimized for the best playback quality, if you will. And if you push a lot of RMS level into a D-to-A converter like this, or even into the eighth-inch jack that you'll find in a laptop, it may be changing the sound. It may be adding some distortion. There may be a little bit of compression, if you will, maybe an elevated noise floor. If you're trying to assess the quality of mixes or masters at a high level, it's a reason to invest in a high-quality D-to-A converter and a high-quality playback amplifier. So just something to keep in mind. It's especially important that you think about the level of the materials that you're using as references. Going back to this notion of a mix and the sound of a mix potentially being different from the sound of a master, especially when it comes to level. If you have a lot of master tracks that you use as references and try to match your mixes to those mastered references, it will inevitably cause you to want to push your mix levels up. In the context of your mixing work, I would recommend that you get in the habit of taking your reference tracks and knocking the level down so that you're not struggling to get the level of what you're working on up. At the end of the day, it is an interesting observation to make about how the sound's coming from the speakers, how clear it is, how punchy, and what the level is compared to a mastered track. But you don't want to hold yourself to the criteria of getting all the way up to the level of a mastered track while you're mixing. There'll be time for that later. So I hope that's been helpful. If you're adding level just for level, stop. If you're adding level because it's getting you something that you like better and it sounds better, it's all good. Just recognize that you might have to turn it down when it comes time to master. So thanks for watching. I'll look forward to seeing you in another episode of Are You Listening? I'm Jonathan Wyner. Take care.